welcome to Dead Air Live, and we are live tonight from Somerville. And our show is called Streetwise tonight because we're going to be taking a look at some street musicians that play around in the streets of Boston. So without further ado, let me start by introducing our first street musician, Richard Esmon, and he's going to play some songs, and then we'll come back and talk. Take it away, Richard.
Thank you.
And then we'll chat a bit.
Okay.
This is Richard Esmon.
Thank you.
Okay, that was great. That was, what a beautiful world.
What a wonderful
world. What a wonderful world. I love that song. What was the first song?
I Can't Get Started.
Oh, right.
It's a good one to begin with.
Yeah, that's an old one.
Before my time.
Okay. Well, thanks for playing those songs. So now, you are a street musician in Boston.
Yeah.
And where do you mostly perform?
In the colder weather, in the subways. Mm-hmm. When it gets warmed up out in front of Jordan Mash or anywhere I can find a spot. There are quite a few guys doing it now, so.
Well, you've got your act down. I mean, you certainly were smooth. I think there was a crowd developing, but they had a train to catch.
Yeah, right. Yeah, I played professionally years ago, all of us.
Uh-huh. Yeah. And tell me a little bit about the setup you have here.
Well, I do my own background from a keyboard, and I put it on tape, which I play from this thing, and then I play along with it.
Is this a pretty professional tape recorder?
Yeah, you have to have good stuff to do it with. This is quite expensive. Harmonicas are very expensive, too much so. Now, they gold plate it, which you don't need.
Uh-huh.
And like this one here is like $300.
Let's have a close-up on this harmonica. Which camera do you want to hold this to? Two. This is Richard's gold plated harmonica. And is this a chromatic?
Yeah, it's a chromatic.
So
yeah.
That means it plays every note of the scale.
It's got like four. Octaves on a piano, it'd be
four
like that.
Four octaves on a piano, and this.
It's quite a range to it,
yeah. Wow, okay.
Beautiful instrument. This is probably, when I started years ago, they never had them like this. This is really a fantastic harmonica. It's really nice. Yeah.
Just play a scale for me, and maybe we can get a close-up, and you can see how you know.
Here's
you.
This one.
Oh, no, oh. Just, wait. I want to see how you do. You don't you have to press this thing in and then?
Yeah, right. Well, I'll go. Like
right, so what's the button on them?
That gives the sharps or flats.
Sharps
in other words, this would be the black notes on the piano if you pushed in on it, the white notes when it's open.
And you have
just
to
like a piano.
And breathing in and out, that's kind of
yeah,
tricky.
It makes it tough on faster tunes to get legato because of that fact that you have to blow and draw. Whereas sax, I played sax years ago, you just take a deep breath and move your fingers and you can go really fast, get legato.
What happens if you have to play a lot of notes all in a row where you're breathing in?
You run out of wind. Yeah. It's tough. Yeah.
Okay. So let's talk a little bit about the scene, the street scene here in Boston. I mean, how did you decide to play out in the street?
I had done it years ago in New York in Times Square. I'm talking about maybe 40 years ago. In those days, it was illegal.
Uh-huh.
They'd arrest you. I played with two other guys. One guy had a bass. On a tub, you ever seen those?
Yeah.
And I played the harmonica with a little amp, and then another fellow played guitar, jazz mostly, and sang. And when you drew a crowd, the cops would come, and they'd literally arrest you for this. And I could get away, all I had was the harmonica, but this guy with the tub, they'd catch him every time. And then I saw people doing it around here, and I said, I didn't know if they'd like my music, where it's dated, the old standards and stuff. So I said, I'm going to try it for the heck of it. So I went out, and I find that young people like it, too, just as much as the old elderly.
Yeah, well, I always seem to think that when you're waiting for the train, or it's a nice sort of, takes you away a little bit, especially something more soothing.
Most of the ballads I do, I find are more popular. I can do a lot of fast stuff, too.
Uh-huh.
It seemed like the ballads what people like most.
So now it was illegal back then in New York, but obviously it's legal now.
Yeah, you have to get a license, get out of the police department for outside playing, and for the tea you have to. They give you a 3-month pass to play, permit to play, and no charge from the tea to do it.
Is it lucrative? I mean, you seem
I'm
to
laughing
make
all the way to the bank.
So people are pretty generous.
Yeah, they are. Harvard Square is a good spot. Almost all of them. I do really well with this sort of thing. Maybe because it's the harmonica. I don't know. It's everyone's tried to play one as a kid. And it's really a popular instrument. I see some of these guys with the blues hat, these kids. They're really good on those things. They get sounds you could never get on a chromatic. It's really incredible to hear some of them play today.
Well, let's hear another song. What do you have in your selection? That
Let's see what we got over here.
Any requests? I don't know your selection, or I would maybe.
Okay, how about Harlem Nocturne? Do you remember that one?
No.
It's on, I used to play it late at night, this tune.
Maybe I'll take a peek at
it. On detective movies and stuff like that.
Okay.
It's an old standard.
Great.
Okay.
Harlem Nocturne. That was great. What do you got? What else you got over here?
This is As Time Goes By.
Oh, okay. As Time Goes By. That's a good one.
I don't think that tune will ever wear out. Thank you.
again, Richard. Just kidding. Before the show, we touched briefly on the topic of something that Boston street musicians seem to be a little bit up in arms about, and that is this idea of television in the subways.
Television cameras.
Television cameras. Tell me a little bit about it.
They've already agreed to, I don't know if they started to install them yet, but they're going to, and that's going to ruin all the music down there, the street musicians. It's going to have, they want sound on it. And we've tried to talk them into not putting the sound, but they're going to put the sound too. They're going to hit advertisements, the same stuff you get, I shouldn't say on TV, but you know, people can get enough of it. We feel that's public property down there, and we have a right to be down there, because we're just a small group of people, but we're going to see what we can do, but I'll keep it going, you know. I don't know if they're going to go to court, I guess, with it over it, you know.
So, is there some kind of collective forming of street musicians? Are
yes,
you all
there is.
In
yeah,
a...
Yeah, there is. It's not a union exactly, but it's just a bunch of people, you know, that in the public support, but we've talked to a lot of people about it. They really like the idea of us playing down there, and it's a shame to do that, you know.
Yeah. Are you signing petitions? Or are you? Is there somebody who's leading the... the group?
I don't think they've got any petitions out or anything.
You said you talked to a lot of people. I'm thinking
I've talked to a lot.
Get a lot of people.
Yeah. And a lot of the other guys have. They don't like the idea of the.
Yeah. You know, I mean, maybe if you get a lot of tea writers
and stuff like that, and some news, and it'll just do away with us. They think that we can play like they're saying in between, but you can't. You know, if you went in between that, and in between the trains, and so forth, it'd be impossible to play down. You couldn't get through a half a tune, you know, without a problem,
Now, do you have a certain turf that you kind of, people know that that's your space? And
no,
is there
any
kind of competition with street musicians?
First come first.
Yeah,
except for Harvard. Over there, there are so many who like to get at Harvard Square that we flip-flop in the morning.
Oh, you do?
I have a flip a coin, yeah. And it's in 5-hour stretches, which... a little long for me. I'm getting old. I don't like playing 5 solid hours.
How long is your repertoire before you have to start, you know?
You mean how many tunes can I do?
Well,
oh, I could play indefinitely. There are thousands of tunes that I know. And if I wasn't so lazy, I don't like to keep recording too much. That's the background, which really gives me a headache. I have to record all this background out. And, I should do more, and I don't. I'm a little lazy. But you've got a captive audience down there. That's good, too. They can't get away from you. But the trains, the way they keep coming and going, you can keep playing. Some guys play maybe 4 or 5 tunes and keep playing them all day because,
the
you know,
same ones.
It's a turnover crowd, so, you know,
Is there anybody else who does this sort of thing? I mean, with the harmonica, are you kind of one of the only ones in Boston?
There's one kid that plays, Michael, he plays. Does the same type of thing I'm doing. He's been running quite a while. Other than that, I don't know of any others with the harmonica in the background, you know, the two together.
Are you from Boston?
Yeah.
And you lived here your whole life?
Yeah.
Except when you were in New York a little
bit. Yeah. I was in New York for a few years, down the village playing like that. I played all over years ago. It was a very popular instrument years ago. And, you know, just sort of, when rock took over, it just
there aren't that many harmonica players.
Not too many that really into it.
Well, Stevie Wonder
hobby.
Was...
Yeah, Stevie Wonder is great. Yeah, he's really good. Tuts Thielemans, he's a real master one. He's jazz harmonicist. He's unbelievable.
What was that? Tuts
Thielemans.
Did you ever bring the keyboard out with you, or was that a
No,
little
this
much?
Is enough to carry without.
Yeah,
I've got one of those 500 Yamahas. It's a big keyboard. So. And they're fantastic. You can get a lot of nice background off of them.
Because I've seen some people out there with little keyboards, and they got the whole setup. And
some of the guys bring the works out. You know, they take up half the station, it seems like.
Should we have Richard play another song? Play one more song before we... Okay, let's pick out
one more song.
Give me a choice of three over there, and I want to pick out the last one.
You want to pick out one. Let's see. I got 3 left.
I'll pick one out
of you're going to choose that one, right? Talk of the Town, you remember that one? Really a nice tune.
Misty, what about Misty?
I'll have to go way into the tape to reach it.
Oh, okay,
all
right.
I can't take requests, I'd have to have 1,000 tapes with
me. Okay, well then I'll settle for Talk of the Town.
Okay.
Okay, so this is Richard Esmond, who's going to play his last tune for us, Talk of the Town.
I made a full orchestral arrangement background with this one. I like it though.
This is a full orchestra arrangement?
Well, it's done with the keyboard.
Oh,
you can hear it.
Okay, Richard Esmond and Talk of the Town. Well, you can play Talk of the Town or Misty for me anytime.
Okay.
And now we're going to take a little segue into our next street musician with a tape of an old Somerville Producers Group tape of David Misch, recorded back in 1975. David is doing his Bob Dylan imitation, and the song is Positively Bunny Street.
Positively Bunny Street.
Okay. Well, I think he was doing what I was asking Richard about, him breathing in and out, and I don't know, it was like hyperventilating harmonica kind of thing. Well, we're back live here in Somerville on Dead Air Live with our Streetwise Street Musician Show. And our second guest for the second part of the show is Eric Trurin, and he is here to play a little guitar for us. So perhaps we'll get right into the playing and then come back and talk to Eric Trurin. Okay.
Like a compact, another business contact. We're hoping the economy grows. Climbing up the ladder, it doesn't seem to matter when we step on a couple of people below. Well, there's a swarm of killer neckties. They're out on the loose. Without a warning, they'll attack you. You tighten the noose because you're climbing up the ladder, and it doesn't seem to matter when you step on a couple of people below. You dominate the people below. I'm walking down the street, it's such a sunny day. There's people passing by me, so I smile and I wave. Neckties and sore eyes that turn away. There's people passing by me and I wait. There's people passing by me and I wait. Well, there's a swarm of killer neckties. They're out on the loose. Without a warning, they'll attack you. You'll tighten the noose because you're climbing up the ladder, and it doesn't seem to matter when you step on a couple of people below. You dominate the people below. About the people when the bill is fully paid. Big business, bureaucracies, they're all the same. They substitute a number for your name. They substitute a number for your name. Well, there's a swarm of killer neckties. They're out on the loose. Without a warning, they'll attack you. And you'll tighten the noose because you're climbing up the ladder, and it doesn't seem to matter when you step on a couple of people below. You dominate the people below.
Great. You want to try another one?
Sure, I can play another shot.
Okay, play another one.
I'd kind of rather stand up. Is that okay?
Sure. Yeah.
I hadn't really thought about that.
Eric would rather stand up. Let's just move this back a little.
One quick change.
Swarm of Killer Neckties. What was that song called?
Killer Neckties.
Killer Neckties. I think I've seen that swarm.
Yes.
I think I've run into that.
They're everywhere. Everywhere.
Yeah.
You just can't really avoid them, especially here.
Earlier today, in fact.
Yeah.
Okay. We can play another one.
Okay. This song is called Burger Queen.
Okay. Great.
It's about a girl in a Burger King. In the home of the Whoppers.
Susie feels like a queen, like a person portrayed in some teen magazine. Burger fries and Coca-Cola, flick of the wrist to make the register ring. Order after order, order in the court of the Burger King. Well, she doesn't know how to marry, whether for money or love. She never seems to find both in boys that she thinks highly of. She could always stay single, have a career, and probably move to New York. She could find a steady lover there and help her drink champagne. He could pop the cork, but she's so cautious in love, overly sensitive, cruel. She never listens to mama, but never stays home from school. She often dreams of horses, having a pony that she can call her own. A friend she can depend on to spirit her away and take her far, far from home. But here in the home of the Whopper, Susie feels like a queen, like a person portrayed in some teen magazine. Burger fries and Coca-Cola, a flick of the wrist to make the register ring. Order after order, order in the court of the Burger King. Order after order, order in the court of the Burger King.
Okay. You want to pull your chair back just for a minute?
I can do that.
Okay. So I take it these are original songs.
These are original songs.
And how long have you been songwriting?
Oh, I don't know, probably 14, 15 years, mm-hmm. something like that.
So, and you've always been playing the guitar, or?
I started playing the piano when I was about 5.
And then, most people do, don't they? It's
yeah.
The piano lessons.
Then I moved on to trumpet.
Did you?
Played trumpet for about 3 years.
Huh, it's kind of like me.
Oh, well. See, and then I, the whole time I was singing, did a lot of singing. My dad was a music teacher. It was difficult not to sing.
Oh, my dad wasn't a music teacher.
Yeah, so I was sort of, you know.
So the piano to the trumpet, and then the guitar.
And then the guitar. I didn't pick up the guitar till I was 18.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess it's been 14 years.
So do you mostly play solo, Eric?
Mostly. But I sometimes play with other people.
Uh-huh. And when you play with other people, do you play locally with a group around Boston?
I've played with different sort of smaller things. I've done some recording projects and played. I really haven't played out that much. I did a Bunratty's gig once wearing a leopard suit. That was kind of fun.
Wait, you wore a leopard suit?
I was wearing, a lizard suit.
You
I had a lizard suit, yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Yeah. I played with my friend Jeff from the Well Babies.
Okay, as opposed to a killer necktie. You didn't.
I had no killer necktie on at the time, no. In fact, I try to avoid wearing it.
Okay, now with our street musician theme, I know that we've, you know, gone a little bit away from that, because you said you
Slightly.
Used to play in Harvard Square years
right,
ago.
Right, back in the, like, the mid-80s. When I first moved to Boston, I started playing in the square.
Mm-hmm. Was that lucrative? Was it successful?
I didn't feel that it was going to be successful for me.
It was kind of hard.
Yeah. Well, I would have had to learn a lot of standard songs, I think, to be able to keep a crowd. And I think standard songs are lovely.
Yeah.
But I just don't have time to memorize a whole bunch of them. And
right. You'd rather write your own stuff.
So I became a bike courier instead.
Right, I think I remember that.
That was the other, you know, the other thing you can do when you're a musician, besides
on the street.
On the street.
And still,
be
so we're still with that street theme.
Streetwise, indeed.
Yeah.
Yes.
So how long were you a bike courier?
Off and on for about 7 years.
That's a tough job.
Yeah. I ended up owning a bike courier company.
Oh, really?
Yeah, ultimately, and then giving it away.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Well, maybe we should talk about that.
Yes, that's a separate issue.
Yeah, okay. So now music is your primary...
It's my primary hobby.
Okay.
It's my favorite hobby. But I don't get to do it as often as I would like. I do still have to have a day job, you know.
Do you want to tell us about your day job, though?
I could, but...
For another show?
Yeah. That's
okay.
It. We could do a small business show sometime.
You don't wear a necktie.
I don't wear a necktie, okay. No.
So your inspiration from your songs comes from sort of...
Just reading. I read a lot. I'm always reading. And it seems like the more I read, the more I notice that the world is a horrible place for most people, aside from us lucky white folks in America.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I noticed a few statements on society in the lyrics.
Uh-huh. Yeah, and it's not really getting to be all that much better for us anymore either. So.
Uh-huh. And do you, besides coming on Somerville Producers Group and playing out a few times, do you have any other way to get your music out to people?
I have a couple of tapes. Mm-hmm. And whenever I can afford it, I'll go into the studio and just record things to have it, because I have 40 or 50 songs, so I like to kind of keep them around. Mm-hmm. But I don't really see any reason to try to sell them in particular. I'm not I have a business for that. I don't really want to turn music into my mm-hmm. business. Mm-hmm. And that's the other reason I didn't like the street that much, because mm-hmm. you're always out selling yourself and
right.
selling music.
Yeah.
And I think it's a nice thing, street music. I always give people money that I see playing street music, but
it's hard.
It's hard, and it's a wonderful thing. However, it was not really my calling. I could tell mm-hmm. that music is much more to me than something to share with passersby.
I would think the biggest thing about being a street musician, where you're playing in a club and you have the audience and they're there and they're pretty much attentive and they clap and things.
Right.
You just never know. I mean,
right.
you see the people in the subway and they almost don't want to, they almost don't want to pay attention, and then at the
right.
very end maybe they'll
exactly.
throw something, but
they're always sort of looking the other way.
It's not a lot of reinforcement for someone who, if it's a performer, who maybe needs that reinforcement.
Right. Well, especially if you're playing songs no one recognizes.
Mm-hmm.
There's a certain recognition on the song level that everyone can relate to. But if they can't even relate to that, they're certainly not going to relate to you.
Right.
That's what I found anyway. I played probably 20 or 30 times, and found that really, the only time anyone gave me any money at all was when I played a song they recognized.
Stairway to Heaven.
Well,
let's hear a couple more of your own original songs then, as long as you have the stage.
I'll do that.
Okay.
I'll do a couple of sort of, I don't know, I guess they're war-oriented songs.
Okay.
Anti-war.
Good. That's anti-war. Good. We're all for that here. All right. Eric Schurin.
So this song is New World Order. Come on now, let's have no more violence on the earth. And in this world where freedom slips from us at birth. That the only way to be is watching your TV and thinking everything's okay. We won the war, and hey, this is the new world order. Now, if it's true, the USA is number one. Because we make such killer high-tech guns, then we go selling all our military duds like antiquated scuds to any sicko at the block. We'd rather shoot than talk here in this new world order. I don't know who has all the money in the world, but somehow I wish that it could be a little girl who only wants to see that everything's all right and everyone sleeps tight and there's no hunger on the earth. She could show us what it's worth to have it. Come on now, let's have no more violence on the earth. And
in this new world where civil rights are lost at birth. Please don't believe that the only way to be is watching your TV and thinking that everything's okay.
Okay, why don't we hear another one?
One more song.
You have another anti-war song?
Well, this song is called Tug of War, but it only really gets to that every once in a while. Really only once. So, okay, so we can, it has a war theme, sort of, but, or anti-war, should I say.
Okay.
It's more anti-technology. Of course, was created for warfare and has only been adapted for more personal, private uses since that time. It follows. I listen to the radio and watch TV. I know what happens in this world around me. I open the refrigerator and I crack another beer. Got the world at my fingertips, but I'm living in fear. So I turn off the TV. I turn off the lights, I turn off the radio and dance all night to forget about the trouble in this world today. Gonna open up your mind, let the trouble get away. Now I notice everybody everywhere is living in a dream. They're thinking like the people on their TV screen. No wonder when I'm drinking, sometimes I scream like a brainwashed child who sees through the scene. I turn off the TV and I turn off the lights. I turn off the radio and dance all night to forget about the trouble in this world today. Gotta open up your mind, let the trouble get away. Gotta open up your mind and let the trouble get away.
Very nice. I like those last two songs a lot.
Thank you.
Yeah. Who inspires you, musicians?
Musically?
Yeah, musically.
Musically inspired by, I don't know, there aren't that many.
Well, back when you started.
When I first started playing, probably just old blues guys whose names I don't even know, you know? And then, everything, really, from southern rock to northern rock to.
What about now?
Seattle,
what do you listen
rock?
To now? What does Eric listen to?
What do I listen to? I listen to the radio.
Okay, what kind of? Everything.
I haven't bought an album in 14, 15. When I bought the guitar, I stopped buying albums. So I don't really collect music. Mm-hmm. I just accept totally random influence.
Because I was just thinking during that last song. You know the group The. It sounded
really
like, yeah, the sort of rhythm in your voice even and the.
That's
did you listen to them much?
Entirely,
not much.
I couldn't even tell you if I heard a the song.
Well, that's kind of good because that means that this is not really related and you're just sort of sounding
it's
like
it's pretty unrelated. Although I actually, my business partner in the courier business was a more of a punk grunge rocker kind of guy. And I picked up a lot of technique from him at one time because I had never seen anyone play like that before. Speed metal, which doesn't...
What's that?
Speed metal is really, really fast heavy metal, I guess. That's the way it's been described to me.
Playing guitar really fast.
Yeah.
Or anything.
Like very chunky. You know. And since there's no acoustic folk equivalent, I was rather fascinated by it.
And you don't play electric guitar.
Not really. Yeah. I have one, but it doesn't work very well. So I'm working on folk metal as a
folk metal.
Folk
just
metal.
Metal strings.
Which is,
no, I don't know.
No, more like a sort of a, I don't know how to describe it really, but.
Okay, well I was just wondering about who.
Punk folk is what I used to do.
Oh really?
Years ago, that's how other people describe my music because it was too abrasive to be folk music, but it was acoustic music and they didn't know what to call it.
Mm-hmm.
So.
And the trumpet, the trumpet is long gone or do you ever pick it up?
It's largely gone. I picked up a trombone a few weeks ago and had a great time. Because of course it's all relative and it was fun.
I was always amazed, like how do they know where the note is, but.
Well, the beauty of the trombone is I don't think you have to, so long as you keep moving, you know?
Okay.
Just try to stop when you get to the right tone.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
Yeah, and then you're in. That's
okay.
Improv, you know?
Well, do you have some others for us tonight?
What's the time? I could play.
We have a few minutes left.
I have a lovely Wordsworth poem.
Yeah. How long is that?
3 minutes? 4 minutes?
Sure, we can do that. And then at some point, are we going to want to roll credits over Eric?
That would be fun.
I'm going to ask the director. Are we going to want to roll credits over Eric at the end? Yes. Okay. Why don't you play your Wordsworth poem, and then we'll see where we are after that.
Okay. It's called Poor Susan.
Okay.
It was written during his pastoral period when he was wandering barefoot across France, looking at the aftermath of the revolution.
So this is not a totally original song. Music put to Wordsworth. Okay.
Has sung for 3 years. Poor Susan has passed by the spot and has heard in the silence of morning the song of the bird. 'Tis a note of enchantment. What ails her? She sees a mountain ascending, a vision of trees, bright volumes of vapor through the loft. And a river flows on through the vale of Cheapside. Green pastures she views in the midst of the day, down which she so often is tripped with her pain. And a single small cottage, a nest like a dove's, the one only dwelling on earth that she loves. Thank you. looks and her heart is in heaven, but they fade. The mist and the river, the hill and the shade. The stream will not flow and the hill will not rise. The colors have all passed away from her eyes. At the corner of Wood Street, when daylight appears, hangs a thrush that sings loud. It has sung for 3 years. Poor Susan has passed by the spot and has heard in the silence of morning the song of the bird. In the silence of morning, the song of the bird. In the silence of morning, the song.
Thank you, Eric, for your songs, and this has been the Somerville Producers Group Dead Air Live tonight. Now, we know we can find our first guest, Richard Esmond, around Harvard Square, our harmonica keyboard player, and in the wintertime he's in the subways. Where might we find you, Eric?
I can start playing the guitar at work. I have a little store in Harvard Square.
Okay, so we can find it.
You can go to 1105 Mass Ave and you'll see me sitting in my store playing the guitar.
Great, well that sounds good.
Although probably I'll have to be working, but you never know.
Okay, that sounds good.
It's the beauty of self-employment.
So you're going to play us out here with one last song and we'll say goodbye for the night. Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Okay.
Myself a jacket from the closet, cause it's windy. Find myself a rocky shelter from the spray, where I can be hidden away. I'll find myself a rock away, where I can watch the storm and play. A place where I can be hidden. Watch the storm and play, a place where I